In this episode, we'll begin a major overhaul of the hydraulic braking system of a 2000 Chev Suburban. We'll discuss the diagnosis and management of an intermittent ABS and parking light on the dash, and we'll demonstrate how to remove the electronic brake control module and reflow solder joints on the printed circuit board.
Good morning, guys. Well, this morning we woke up to a spongy brake pedal in our 2000 Suburban and a big mess of brake fluid on the driveway just in front of the left rear wheel. I think it's going to end up being a rusted out brake line in that area, and we're going to have to fix all those brake lines. But the story's more complex than that.
So here's the situation. About a dozen times over the last year, while driving with my foot on the gas, I've noticed that suddenly I get two lights, an ABS light and a brake light. And those lights stay on for the duration of the trip. Now if I stop and cycle the key, it goes away and it stays away for a few weeks. While the light is on, braking and drivability are completely normal, although I haven't tested the ABS with the light on. I have, however, tested the ABS on a gravel road with the light off, and I can tell you that the ABS motor does kick in and the ABS seems to work normally when the light is off. What's the diagnosis? Here's a glance at a live data stream while driving when the light is off. You can see the individual wheel speed sensors are all working and the PCM is receiving the afferent data stream.
Now, those of you who follow my channel know that I have a love-hate relationship with pretty much every scanner I've used, and Auto Ingenuity, the one that I'm using now, is no exception. I really didn't get much directing evidence from Auto Ingenuity. These are the codes that I got. Now, this is a known issue with the EBCM in this brand of GM. And it's related to loose solder joints inside the EBCM. And so the plan today, while we're waiting for brake line parts, is to remove the entire brake line module, get at the EBCM, and look for loose solder joints and resolder everything we can find. Let's get started.
Now, I should mention that when GM noticed that this was a recurring and common problem, they put out a TSB to make sure that the ground connection for the EBCM is fine before you go at the EBCM itself. And so I'm going to show you where this ground connection is. I've already done this a few months ago, and it didn't help, but it's something you want to do before you go at that. And so you can see the ground connection is right there. It's rusted again, but basically I took that ground bolt out, completely cleaned it all up, and put it back together again, and it made no difference. Okay, let's check that pathway from the ground stud back to the battery. I've disconnected the EBCM just to avoid misadventures. So here we are, 12.28, and then I short circuit, drops down to 12.12. And so that's an excellent voltage drop, meaning that there's very little resistance between that stud and the battery. Now, of course, the elephant in the room is, this doesn't rule out an intermittent. That's much more challenging. Interestingly, this stud goes through some sheet metal with some threads in it, and when I took the stud off to do drop testing, I stripped out the threads a little bit and made it, the connection a little bit tenuous, and so I threw a nut on the back, put some Loctite on it, and I sprayed it down with some fluid film. I don't think it was the cause of the problem, but if I'd left that, that would be a potential cause of a bad connection. I should mention that I partially worked this up a few months ago, getting as far as trying to remove the EBCM until I stripped out the heads of the mounting screws. I paused at that point when I realized I'd have to remove and replace the brake lines if I took it further.
Now, most of my hydraulic fluid leak is under the back wheel here, and undoubtedly it'll be related to a rusted out line, but let me show you where the EBCM lives. It's underneath here. Okay, so that's the EBCM there. You can see an old style fuel filter there, and my line connections to the brake system are right back in there. The EBCM lives on top of the ABS module, and they both live on a bracket, and one of the bolts for the bracket is here, and the other one is here. But I think it might be easier to get the lines off before I take the bracket off so that the I've got something to twist against.
For clarity, here's a drawing from the dealer repair manual. You can see the module is supported by a housing that is held on with three bolts. If you need more room, you can loosen those bolts to let the unit sag down about an inch to rest on the torsion bar. However, you'll also see that mine was hopelessly rusted in place, and I wasn't inclined to drag out the cutting torch with the fuel lines right beside.
All right, let me show you how far I've gotten here. I've labeled each of the lines, A through E, just so I don't get them mixed up. I've got one of the, let's show you here, one of the nuts off. It came off with a 9/16 flare nut wrench.
So I'm just trying to get some of these lines out of the way. These plugs are from the Dorman kit for bleeding the master cylinder. And then these little white things are 3/16 caps that I got separately. And you can see I've pulled the lines off. And now I'm just kind of working my way down. I've labeled them as front and back. I'm pulling the lines off to try and get them loose so I can get them out of my way, because some of those connectors are very hard to get at with the other ones in the way. So we'll just work at this slowly and see if we can't get it done.
So I've got two of the five done, and I'm working on the third. Just push the other lines out of the way. This is always a lot harder than it looks like it might be, just because of the close quarters. All right, let me show you where we are so far. I've got all five of them undone. None of them seized on the tubing, fortunately. Nevertheless, it was pretty awkward trying to get this done. I could have taken off the fuel filter, and in fact, I'm going to do that at one point. I just didn't want to have dripping gas all over the place. Now, this is an Allen screw. I'm going to undo this, and that should undo the whole module, and I should be able to just pull it out. If not, I can take the bracket off. This is one of the bracket bolts. There's another one behind. And I'm going to undo these two electrical connectors now. You just pry off. I'm going to have to set... Oh, there we are. Okay. All right. This is a 732 Allen wrench. It just comes out like that. And then I'll show you this electrical connector. I just took my pocket screwdriver and pried it down this way. And then just wiggle and pull this out. The connector comes free. Now, I'm going to have to put the camera down and just use two hands and try and lift it up and out. We'll see if I can get it out without having to take off the whole bracket. All right, it's out. Let me show you what we've got here. This here, this part here, is the ABS unit, and this part on top is the electronic control module, the EBCM. It's made by Kelsey Hayes. And this is the front of the vehicle, this is the rear, this is the passenger side, and this is the driver's side. And to get this off, I undid this Allen screw here, this 732 Allen. And then I noticed it was still stuck, and it was stuck in the back here on this other one. Now, ideally, you'd be able to put an Allen screw on there and spin it off, but there's no clearance to do that. You're also trapped back here by this little bushing, this little rubber bushing. And these three bushings, the one here, and then one here, hold the unit so it's somewhat cushioned against bumps and jarring with the road. Now, the way I got this out is I pulled it out a little bit this way and then rotated, and I was able to pull it out of the back one, or the side one and the back one, and I got it out and then spun it around and pulled it out that way. Now, the whole reason for doing this is to get the electronic brake control module out. The ABS pump is fine as far as I can tell, and the problem is in the EBCM with some solder joints that need to be resoldered. And to get this off, you need to take a Torx wrench and spin off these four Torx screws right here. Do you see the four of them? And I tried to do that in the car, but my stubby Torx was just not adequate to do it, and I've stripped out a couple of these, so they're going to be a little bit more of a challenge to get off. Now that I have it on the bench, it should be a lot easier to get done. Now, with the device up on the bench, I've got a lot more room, and I was able to get the back two out. This is one of the back two screws back here. But on the car, when I was laying under the car a few months ago, I used a stubby screwdriver, and I wasn't able to get enough purchase on the front two, and I've stripped both of those out. I'll show you what I did here. I'll try the same technique as I did in the back. I'm banging this with a hammer to try and jam it down into the area, and then just push down and twist. And we're not getting anywhere. And so that's the case with both of these. Now, what do we do here? Well, the most common solution is to take a hacksaw and put a slash through the top of this, and that gives allows you to use a flat blade screwdriver and get a little more purchase, and you can pull this out. On this side, we'd have to use a fine multi-master because you don't have enough room to be able to play it. Let's see what I can do here. I've got a little bit of a problem here in that I don't have very good access to this last one, and in particular a hacksaw is going to bump into the end here, and so I'm not going to have enough free play to be able to use it effectively. Now, you can get hacksaws, handmade hacksaws, that are useful in tight spaces, but even so, it'd be a tricky issue. So I'm going to use this device called a fine multi-master. This is the original tool.
Now, since the patent expired, you can buy these for cheap, and it's well worth having a tool in your toolbox, even though I don't use it very often. The generic replacements are much cheaper. Now, I've got a wood and metal blade in, and so we'll just see if this works for us. Felt it move. Oh yeah, there we go. Let's take off the connector here. Now let's very carefully pry up and get this separated. Looks like it's coming. Have a look at what you've got here. On the right you can see six coils, and on the left you can see six plungers that fit inside each of those coils. When each coil is individually activated, the plunger is magnetically pulled against a spring away from its resting position. Those plungers control the flow of brake fluid and flow of ABS pulsations to individual wheels. When activated, the loud ABS motor causes high-frequency pulsations in the column of brake fluid, and the coils direct the flow of those pulsations to individual wheels. Now our next step is to get the two halves of this separated to get the metal part off. And I see we've got some more Torx screws here, and my best fit is T9, and boy, it sure is nice to have a tool set that includes some odd numbers. Maybe this started out as T10, but I can't get the T10 to fit now, so we're going to try and get these screws undone. I hope they're easier than the last ones. Oh yeah, this one is easy. Looks like I missed a couple of screws. I don't know if you can see it, but deep inside there's one screw there and one on the other end. And as I say, T9 seems to fit the best for me. So we'll get those off. Maybe this will come off a little bit easier. So I'm told this next step is painstaking. There's RTV, looks like RTV sealant all the way around there, separating the top side of the case from the bottom. We need to get that out. So I'm going to go all the way around with this X-Acto knife and very carefully separate the two, hopefully without breaking anything. Wish me luck. Almost there. With the magic of time. Now, if you don't want to do this, you can send the whole module in and get a rebuilt one. And given how much time it's taken me to get to the stage that I'm at now, that's not an unreasonable decision, especially in view of the fact that we won't be able to know whether or not the repair has worked until we put it back in the vehicle and try it out. And then by that point, you've invested so much time in it. If the module is bad at the end of it, you're going to have to redo a whole lot of your work. And so there we are.
All right, I need you to look at this for me. I've got you looking through the magnifier, and I honestly can't see any abnormality. All of the joints look fine. The real question here is whether or not we've got crack joints underneath that could be fixed on reflowing the solder from above. Now, I've dealt with the most important thing, and that is the bad screws, so I can get this off at a future date if I need to, but what I've decided to do is to reflow the solder from above with all the big joints, the relay, the power supply, and so forth, and then put it back together again and hope it works. If it doesn't work, we'll take it off and replace the board at a later date. Let's get cracking. Okay, I think I've got them pretty good. I'm just going to wipe off the flux now just so it doesn't stay on the board.
I've got you looking through the microscope to look at two things. The first thing that's going to go through your mind when you're working around with the X-Acto knife is the chance that you're going to cause some harm if you penetrate too deeply. And the answer is the risk is pretty small. Most of the structures that you're going to hit with your X-Acto knife are supporting structures for the board, and they're not sensitive microelectronics. And so you're generally pretty safe, especially if you stay within a few millimeters of the glue line. Now, the second thing that you'll wonder about is, what's this white glue doing here? And this white glue is thermally conductive glue designed to transfer heat from the board out to the housing. You can see it glues to the top part of the housing here. And that glue is potentially a cause for breaking the board as you peel it off. So I didn't have any trouble, but some people have mentioned that they can break the board as you carefully peel it off. So just be careful about that issue. You don't want the board to crack as you're peeling it off. All right, I've gone over the board twice. I've reflown all of the big solder joints, and some of them I've verified that the solder has penetrated through to the bottom, to the base. And I've done just about all I can do here. If it doesn't work now, I've done all I can. After doing that, I took a Q-tip and dipped it in some isopropyl alcohol, and then wiped the board down to get off any contaminants and hairs and things, and then took a rag that's supposed to be a microfiber rag and cleaned it off. And now we're just gonna put the sealant on and put it back together again. This is another form of RTV. Do you know what RTV stands for? Room temperature vulcanizing. Kind of an interesting concept. For these little T9 screws, I'm actually reusing them because they're not that critical. I'll replace the other screws just because they were much more difficult to get out and much more damaged, but these ones seem to be fine. And I'm going to put a little bit of contact cleaner on these surfaces just in case the bad connection problem is right at the connector itself. I'm replacing these four screws. I would have preferred stainless steel and Allen head rather than flathead and nickel plated, but given the age of the car, this will be good enough for my purposes. There's no RTV on here, but you torque them down in a cross pattern. I'm cleaning the shreds with the Q-tip dipped in isopropyl alcohol, and then I'm going to tape it over with some masking tape to try and prevent debris from getting in it while I'm waiting for the new brake lines. All right, moment of truth. I'm actually still up on jack stands and I have no brake fluid because I haven't hooked up any of the lines. And my brake fluid level sensor is unplugged as well, so I wouldn't be surprised if we get a trouble light with that. But I want to just see if that ABS light comes on with starting the vehicle. Let's give it a go. Ah, so the ABS light has come off. Look at that. Ta-da. Well, we've still got more to do, so please stay tuned for the next edition where I replace all of our brake lines. Thanks for watching.